The invocation this evening will be given by Carol Steele with the Willow Road Christian Church. And the flag salute. Pete, how would you like to lead us in the flag salute after the invocation? Carol, thank you for being here.
Let us pray. God of the harvest, we thank you for creating this fertile and beautiful land that we call our home. And as we begin this harvest season, we pray for our farmers and those who work in the agribusiness. We pray for the safety of those who will be in the field in the coming weeks. And we pray for a bountiful harvest. Father, we thank you also for this beautiful city in which we live. And I especially thank you for our first responders, our firefighters, police officers, our EMS crews, all those who help to keep us safe. Also, I pray a blessing on all of our city employees and those who help to make sure that our city runs smoothly. And finally, I pray for the council members tonight. I ask that you would grant them wisdom as they make the decisions that have a tremendous impact upon our community. Father, grant them wisdom as they go about their business this evening. And all this we ask in your holy name. Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item 4. Consider approval of minutes of the Special Commission meeting of May 21, 2015, and regular meeting of June
2, 2015. Move to approve.
Motion by Ben.
Second.
Second.
Second by Rodney. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Item 5, awards, presentations, proclamations, and organizational business. Item 5.1 will present the pet available for adoption at the city animal shelter.
Pound.
A good looking one.
I think about my limit already.
So to Gerald.
Thanks, Mayor.
That's not in the budget.
Yeah. That night for a lack of emotion did.
There you go. Yeah.
You're in business. Item 5.2. Presentation on the Roberts Ranch Smoking Red Dirt Barbecue. Frank Baker.
Mayor Shuey, thank you very much. And we just concluded our 10th anniversary for our Roberts Ranch Smoke and Red Dirt Barbecue, and we would be remiss if each year we didn't come down and thank the city of Enid for their immense support. We really, really couldn't do it without you. Also, glancing over my left-hand shoulder, huge thank you to Keller Taylor and our hosts at the Enid Event Center and Convention Hall. Their support can't hardly even put into words. It is so superb. To give you a little background before we do a presentation with the mayor, I'd like to introduce a lady. I kind of worked for her during the week of the barbecue, Lynn Binkendorf, my colleague at Eagle Marketing.
Thank you. I want to reiterate what Frank had said and to thank the cities behind us. It wouldn't make this thing possible at all. I do want to take this opportunity to thank the employees behind the scenes. The Parks and Recreation Department, they go above and beyond to help with the road closures, the trash, the water hookups with all the new changes, and especially Roy Robbins' crew at the technical services. If it wasn't for them and their electrical staff, we wouldn't be able to hook everything up. And Frank Sweet went above and beyond this year. We had, there was a section that had some teams that didn't have electricity. They were kept blowing some breakers, and he spent about 3-4 hours just making sure that everything was set up and they were running smoothly. So we want to say thank you to them. For 10 years, barbecue in Enid for 10 years, who would have thought? When some people think of barbecue, you think of Kansas City barbecue, think of Memphis. Well, after 10 years, Enid has become quite the spot for contests, for teams to come to Enid. And I think that is in part because of the red carpet that we roll out for them and how that we welcome them, and the city is behind us. So, again, thank you so much. We have, after 10 years, we first started with Habitat for Humanity. We helped them with the proceeds from this event. They were able to build 4 or 5 houses from this event. Proceeds from this event over the last 10 years, $25,000 has gone back into the Enid schools and the area schools art departments. Over the last 10 years, $25,000 has gone into our local market dimes. We've had helped with Enid and Ambucks. They're our partners, so they've been able to purchase several Amtrikes. They were able to help actually build and improve Miracle League Park and ABC Park. So all that is based on this community event, the regular barbecue. So we want to thank you so much. And Mayor Shuey, if you could come down, I'll ask Mr. Frank to present this to you.
Come join us for the photo.
So on behalf of Enid News Eagle, Eagle Marketing, Roberts Ranch, Enid and Ambucks, we want to say thank you to the City of Enid.
We thank you.
We may all have to paint the room that we hang these pictures in. Under item 6, hearings, there are none. Under item 7, community development, there are none. Under item 8, administration, item 8.1, consider a resolution amending the 2014-2015 Enid Event Center and Convention Hall fund budget by appropriating additional funds in the amount of $627,000 to increase the 2014-2015 appropriated amounts for the Enid Event Center and Convention Hall Department.
Move approval. Second.
Motion by David, second by Aaron. Further discussion? Please cast your vote.
Well done, Aaron.
Item carry 7-0. Item 8.2, consider a resolution amending the 2014-2015 Water Capital Improvement Fund budget by appropriating additional funds in the amount of $696,000 to increase the 2014-2015 appropriated amounts for the Water Capital Improvement Department.
Move approval.
Motion by David.
Second.
Second by Aaron. Further discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Item 8.3, execute an agreement with Garver, LLC, Little Rock, Arkansas, for the alternate water supply from Carl Lake Project Number W-1412A in the amount of $1,196,000. And authorize the mayor to execute all contract documents after review by the city attorney.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by Tammy. Second by Ron. Further discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Item 8.4, approve change order number 1 with PPS Trucking Limited Liability Company, Hennessy, Oklahoma, for the Rolling Oaks Detention Facility and Drive Realignment. Project number F-1307A in the amount of $491,853.20.
Thank you, Mayor.
Sorry, Robert.
Yes, sir, I believe I can cover the project. This is the Rolling Oaks Detention Project. Mayor and Commissioners and City Manager, I'm glad to present this project. This is a change order on the project to add the Rolling Oaks Drive realignment. And first I'm going to cover that the project is laid out to cover approximately 27 acres that we are improving as stormwater detention. The project is, of course, designed under contract for the detention facility. And the excavation of the north part of the project is in place. The change order that's on the agenda tonight is to add the Rolling Oaks driveway realignment. It was bid with the original project, but it was deferred. We wanted to have this contractor get underway, do the excavation work and the improvements in place before coming back with the change order. So it is a bid, petty bid amount. And we'll talk also about the wet detention that's in the plan in the future phase. I'll show you on the screen here is the layout of the project. North is to my left and to your left, particularly. And Cleveland is on the side of the exhibit here. See the water features is built part of the PUD development for Stonebridge. And on the left side of the north edge is the area that's under improvement for a stormwater detention facility. And that includes excavating this area to provide a basin. We also have a paved channel to carry the large flow through. And we'll talk about this area in the corner in just a minute. There is plans called for a water feature. There's plans for a water feature in the corner of the facility there that would catch the flows coming off from the west, actually. But that is in a future phase for construction. It's not in the current contract. This is just a blow up of that showing the area of the water feature. I'll go back a little bit. What is the current phase is a substantial amount of the soil has been removed from this site. They have excavated from the west to the east, and they're moving towards the east with the excavation to provide to lower that plain to provide for storage of stormwater. We have recently moved the Cleveland Street drainage into the basin temporarily to take any pressures off of properties downstream that may see high water flows from storm events. And that's the purpose of the project. This change order would add the placement of a box culvert, multi-cell box culvert under or to the south existing Rolling Oaks Drive and realign the drive across to put it further away from railroad tracks. So from this drawing, the existing drive that comes up just south of the railroad crossing, that's a hydraulic problem for carrying water under it. And it's also a safety.
see it on the road surface there, and that's a dry basin to store stormwater. We, in the future plans, call for additional excavation in the corner of that facility to provide for a permanent pond or water surface elevation, very comparable to what's being done, been in place.
When you go back, when you go back to that picture.
Doesn't look like the other picture.
Looks nothing like it.
And that backup picture, that back, the color picture is the picture that we voted on and approved and told everybody there was going to be a lake. So now it's going to be dry? What, that's not the same picture. Those are not the same thing.
Wait a minute.
That is not in the corner, like what they're saying. That is not even remotely the same picture.
I think the
I don't understand all the engineering stuff, but that's not the same picture.
That to me is the same picture.
It is not the same thing at all. The other picture is showing the lake down in the corner by the yellow part, not where that lake is. That is not the same picture.
And that's correct.
That is what we voted on, and that is what we told the public was happening.
You can't make a lake out of a detention pond, Tammy. It's for flood.
This is what was supposed to happen, period. That is what we voted on, and that is what we agreed upon.
Tell me what changed.
The agreement. That is the PUD that was presented to the city, not that other picture.
Yeah, how can we have a walking trail around a dry pond and then the wet in the other corner?
That is not at all.
I mean, looking at your elevation in the prior slide, I kind of zoomed in here on my screen. I know it's hard to tell, but that reflects the ultimate elevation, but it's just not consistent with the PUD.
Not at all.
I think the problem comes in when we did the actual engineering. That rendering there, that picture was not possible. Is that right?
That picture is 3 years, 2 or 3 years old.
I agree with you. It is. But I think when this picture was done, was the detailed engineering and the grading plan done for all of that?
You don't just get to change it.
Yeah. This was just an exhibit for the plan unit development. You're correct.
It's not just a concept, because that is the picture that whole neighborhood stood up here and agreed upon when that neighborhood was mad about this happening and they wanted a buffer between those two neighborhoods. This was the picture that they agreed they would be okay with, and they didn't sue us over, because if you recall, there was attorneys and everybody else here the night we had that meeting, and we all came to an agreement that was what was going to happen. That's the picture that we all agreed upon, with the community standing in this room agreeing that they were okay with that plan.
That picture doesn't have dimensions of...
It doesn't, but they're two completely different locations. I'm not talking about inches and feet and specific details like that, but that's not even the same location.
It also seems a little bit disingenuous to say, well, when it came to engineering, that wasn't possible. I mean, we are, no matter how it's cut, we, the developer, whoever's doing it, is dramatically changing the grade of an enormous chunk of dirt into the day, and to come back and say, well, we didn't do what was approved in the PUD because we wanted to dig the dirt somewhere else, just seems a bit disingenuous.
Incredibly.
I don't understand what the limitation of the PUD as a planning mechanism is. My understanding was that when we approve PUD, we are making a trade-off with the developer. In exchange for additional oversight from the city, the developer gets some exceptions. But the flip side being that when you show the city a plan, you're committing to develop along those lines. Andrea, when we approve a PUD that incorporates this, what kind of restrictions are upon the developer?
The developer is required to do everything under the PUD that he promises to do. That portion to the north, that's not the developer of the PUD.
Well,
that portion is the city's.
Okay. Okay. So that's not.
So it's not truly part of that PUD.
Well, but when we approved the PUD, it was that picture.
It was based on that picture, and that's the picture that the community agreed to not file a lawsuit about.
Well, and, threatening to sue isn't exactly the trade-off here, but it's...
No, but still, but the thing is they agreed to not argue anymore about that if we did that, what was in that picture. Hmm. And that's what we agreed to do.
Yeah.
And this is why people get mad at the city all the time, because they change crap and they don't tell people they're changing.
Let me point out, this is the plan that was developed and presented for a board at that project, and sorry if it wasn't clear, but this was the plan that was presented at that time. The other issue, there's a couple of technical issues of extending the water feature over here too far to the east, because the flow for this box culvert would probably make that water feature, the high flows would probably make that very difficult to maintain. It would wash out and make it very difficult to maintain. That's one of the engineering reasons why it was put over here, and also to provide more green air. But that's a reason for the design as
well. That's an open culvert?
This is a box culvert, yes, sir.
After you exit right there, what is that from there to the pond? That's underground?
This is an underground box structure. This is an open area here, which would basically be part of the detention. And this would be, this would slope into a basin, which would be...
What's the line that runs across and down and then over and ends up in that other?
That is a concrete flume to carry low flows through the structure during those low flows like sprinklers, etc.
Underground or open? I'm not asking the question.
It's above ground. It's a flume, concrete paved channel.
It's an open hole.
Right.
It's going to look terrible.
It's going to look terrible.
So
very similar to the detention facilities at the service center.
This is a neighborhood, not a service center.
This will look kind of like the detention facility at Prairie View.
Right.
Okay, where you have a concrete channel running down the middle of it. But because of the flows that we will see underneath Rolling Oaks Drive, we can't run those flows through the wet feature.
To the what, Chris?
Through the wet feature. We'll blow it out. Now, we can enlarge the wet feature some, easily enough, obviously, but we have to watch where our flows come from.
The part right now that's dug out that backs right up to is that Meadow Lake Drive, those homes that are right along in there. That's, 10 feet from them? That's going to be the dry part?
Everything that you see out there will actually be dry, with the exception of where we put the wet feature.
The wet feature is going to be where he just mentioned.
Maybe not.
Not where they said.
I'd have to kind of agree with Tammy and Ben on this. That's really not what I had envisioned to do to those neighbors either. I thought we were putting a lake in front of their house. It was going to look really nice.
And I also, when I'm sitting here, I pulled up the PUD from the July 2nd, 2013 agenda. I don't know if this is as it was approved. I'm sitting here, searching on my computer for the, but it does define a stormwater detention recreational pond. Pond located in Track 2, it's referring to a pond in Track 2. I mean, it doesn't define it necessarily. It does reflect that permanent water will be maintained in the pond for recreational use by residential portions of the project. Pedestrian trails will be established around the pond, connect to other sidewalks. I mean,
That's the south part.
It was pretty clear.
There's two wet parts there. The south part is the developer's portion, and that's what that is describing.
Well, no, track that says two in track two.
All of that is track two.
Not
what?
According to the other drawing.
Yeah, go back to the diagram that shows track two.
Let's
Robert,
look our
please.
Picture here. It is. Okay.
That's all track two. So that's
the whole green thing is
that
track
two.
Yes,
technically is track two. Well, that isn't what we, that's not, this is what we agreed on. This picture is what we agreed on. This picture is what the neighborhood agreed on. This picture is the thing that everybody, at the end of the day, after weeks and weeks of fighting about, that's the what we agreed on. Not this new, that is not what we
surprised.
So track two is all owned by the city? Did I hear you say that?
Who owns the dirt?
Track two is, the north portion up here is owned by the city, and I believe the entire tract is owned by the city with, the north portion is owned by the city. The south portion is an easement, is an easement to the
which
city.
Which was done.
The developer did all the work on that.
Right, on an easement. Yes. Yeah, it's about right here. This is owned by the city, and this is will be part of the common area to be maintained by the association, but the city retains an easement for stormwater management purposes.
So how can we get out of this dilemma? We can't.
You vote no?
We can't have everybody unhappy about that. So what's the solution to?
Well, if you might. The wet detention is planned for the next phase, because we need to finish the construction of what we got going, the excavation. We need to relocate Rolling Oaks Drive. We need to make sure that all that process works, that it flows properly. Then we'll go back and do the final design on the wet detention. and we'll award that as a separate contract, as was our intention.
Where do you anticipate that would go, Chris? What will that look like to us?
We're engineers. We like it in the corner.
That's what they're talking about, is putting it down here in the corner.
But we also understand that there's...
One up by Rolling Oaks or down in the...
There.
Right there.
See, the plan was it's supposed to be up along, be a buffer between Rolling Oaks and that. That was the whole freaking point of that, was the whole point. And now that is not even remotely the same thing.
And we can enlarge that some, and we can move it around some.
It's on the other side.
What we really can't do very easily is put it to where the Rolling Oaks flow comes directly into it. That's where we get into trouble.
What happens to flood control?
Nothing. It works.
I guess the question is, go back to the plat.
Wait a minute. I don't understand your answer, Chris.
What happens to flood control?
Yes.
If we put in...
Detention ponds are for flood control, not for lake.
Yes. What we will do is we'll excavate the dry detention area that we need to manage the 100-year event, and then we will come back and dig deeper to put in a wet detention facility, and the water will stand there and probably will end up needing to aerate it or something to keep the growth down.
The wet facility is going to be
below,
right south of the apartments.
There will be two wet facilities.
The one he's talking about, see where that blue one is on the end here? It's not going to be there. It's going to be down in that corner by the yellow. That is not what we agreed on. That is not what we voted on. That is not what that neighborhood stood in here and agreed on. That is not what we fought for 8 weeks. That is not what we did. Not at all what we did.
Times of heavy rain, though, that whole section could be
underwater. With enough rain, there will be a lot of water in there.
Wait, in that case, can we put a pedestrian trail around it if the whole thing's going to be flooded?
Not a problem. We're going to have trickle channels in there. You just won't be able to walk on it.
It's a question of how much money. But
it is a question of money.
It sounds like we need to look at the engineering on the wet feature again. If to try and get as close, I don't know how close we can get to this, because I think what I hear engineering telling me is that we could not replicate this exactly. Is that right? Do we need to look at some more engineering to see if that can happen? I think you just talked about the flow doesn't flow well to the deep end on that side close to Cleveland. Is that what you're saying?
It took us 2 years to figure that out. Really? Well, 2 years?
But that's a color photo. That's not, we probably should have looked at more engineering. I hear what you're saying. We need to look at the engineering on that and try to make it match that photo.
Yeah, that's the plan. That was what was supposed to happen.
Well,
I'm being unreasonable.
Wait a minute, Ben.
Sorry.
I don't think it's unreasonable to expect what we voted on and what we approved and what we agreed on to happen. I don't think I'm being unreasonable. I think that this is a bunch of crap, and I'm so incredibly livid about this right now, I can't even explain to you how mad I am. This is nonsense, and this should never have happened.
Well, and we did have a version of this discussion in July of 2013. I mean, looking at the minutes for that meeting, Commissioner Ezell asked if there was a more in-depth description of the modified PUD than that being shown on screen, and asked where those modifications were being defined in the motion. He stated there was no agreement with the property and the other. As we go on, Mr. Benson stated that should there be any deviations from the modified PUD as described, those changes would have to be approved by the City Commission. We knew that if there were changes, it would have to come to the City Commission. And we knew and we talked about a description that may not have entailed enough evidence or enough information, but what we had was that picture. So that was the PUD as approved unanimously, by the way. And I understand if that doesn't provide engineering with a lot to go on, but those changes, that is a substantial change to the PUD. Before we could begin construction on the contract as approved, I think the PUD would require modification, because that is a substantial deviation from the PUD as approved by the commission. So I don't know if we even can approve this contract tonight. And if we did, and knowing that neighborhood, we would be in a lot of hot water. So before we get to the point of approving contract, let's make sure we're in the clear. There's not a lot in that meeting, but that's the meeting where it was approved.
There's nothing in this contract change that addresses digging wet detention.
Is it just the road?
We picked the spot that made the most sense to us based on the engineering and the hydraulics. We're not doing that. That actual construction is not ready to happen yet. We're talking about changing the contract to relocate Rolling Oaks Drive so I can get my flows through there and into this detention facility.
The drive has to be done before you work on the detention facility?
And we already have a motion and a second, so it'd just be...
We still can comment.
I mean, and Ms. Wilson, obviously, will come up with a different plan.
Yeah, we'll definitely look at trying to make it match this as closely as we can. If the road is approved tonight, is that going to in any way mitigate the ability to try and make the wet feature look like this picture?
It'll consume some of the space, but not a significant amount.
Well, but part of what we're approving tonight, along with the road, is going to determine the inlet structure, and the location of the inlet structure may change based on...
The box culvert under the road cannot change. That's where
the location of it cannot change.
That's where the water's got to come in. 573 cubic feet per second in a 100-year event. That's where the water's got to come in.
So then the answer is, if they approve that tonight, we can look at the engineering to make the wet feature match that picture.
Yes.
But our ability to do that won't be hampered in any way, because what you're saying is that the inlet has to be where it is.
The inlet has to be where it is. The dry detention has to be at a given elevation, and the wet detention will be below that given elevation, what we call the storage elevation.
I just want to make sure super clear on this. The image of page 3 of Robert's presentation tonight, I'll go back one more. Okay. That is what we are approving tonight. A portion of that. What portion of that does the contract that we are approving tonight incorporate?
Incorporates placing this box structure here under the roadway and paving the roadway to connect to...
That's it. Cleveland. That's all this contract incorporates.
That's it.
That's it.
We are not marrying ourselves to any more of this engineering drawing by
Correct.
Tonight's... Okay. Got it then.
Clarify for me that the $1 million that we've already spent, because this is a change order to another contract.
This is a change order to the existing contract to excavate that dry detention area.
We still have
to come back to you with, here's the contract to do the wet detention.
Got it.
So potentially some of this first contract is going to either be redone or has been wasted by the time we move the wet. No?
No,
it's
sir.
All been fine. Okay.
Yes, sir. And we'll put a field order together to make sure that we don't put in our trickle channels until we've settled on wet detention.
Yeah, I just don't want to get
reworking.
I just don't want to get stuck at the point where we would have to theoretically go back and redo things. That's
to me okay. When you put in the Rolling Oaks detention facility and driver realignment, I thought you had to do them both at the same time.
They were awarded on the same contract. Competitively. We just did not execute the relocation of Rolling Oaks Drive at that time.
Okay.
I'm still concerned how that even the dry part looks to the neighbors. Is it that we're not talking about changing that 6-foot drop off that's just right across the street, even with the wet feature that you're talking about. So
it'll be grassed.
It's kind of disappointing in a way that that's going to look awfully bad for those.
It'll look like willow. Or not Willow, Prairie View.
Prairie View.
No, it already looks worse than Prairie View. It's a deep hole.
It's all dirt right now, too.
Yeah. Well, I have to take your word for it that it's going to look better, but right, it's I'm concerned how that's going to look to the neighbors.
It will be,
what is it, 4 foot, 6 foot berm or hole? On the dry side.
It's at least, it looks like it's 6 feet now. But
yeah, I think it's about 6 feet, and then there's probably about a 3 foot berm on the north side to protect the low road.
9 foot top to bottom hole. But we got to move the road. I mean, that's.
Yeah, yeah.
And we really need the stormwater detention.
We all know we need it. It's the location.
Of the wet.
Well, one necessitates the other.
One, I'm sorry, you didn't.
Yeah.
One follow-up question. Go back to the colored picture just because it has the red arrow on it that I want. We've had, you probably, maybe you've already dealt with this, but this whole thing has created flooding south of where that red dot is, or the red arrow down there. What are we doing about that, Chris?
One of the things was we opened up that inlet into that dry detention.
Right? What we did is we've did a camera of the drainage pipe to the south of that property to see if there were any obstructions, and there weren't. We're modeling that structure to see what its capacity is, and is there something that's not working right. We also bermed up the west side of Cleveland just north of where the apartment property is at. So we take all the flow that's coming out of Hunter's Hill and it goes in through this detention. We already have our field drains in place for what comes out of Rolling Oaks. So it gets into this detention. So it looks like we've addressed it.
The water goes which direction?
The water goes where, sir?
South.
Which direction?
It goes south through the small center of our detention facility.
He's on the west side of Cleveland?
On the west side of Cleveland, it goes into the detention facility and goes south to the Walmart parking lot where our discharge structure is at. And then it goes through a pipe and gets under Chestnut. Makes 290s and gets under Chestnut.
Goes over to a channel from there?
And there's a channel in there, south of Chestnut.
Sadly, it takes another tremendous rain to prove it, prove it's right.
Sadly, yes. But I look at how our systems performed on the west side, mm-hmm. with all the work that we've done over there on Garland North and Willow, or in Prairie View, and the Walmart detention, and we're on the right track.
Was there any flooding in that area? There was
none that
some,
I'm aware of.
There was some south of the... south of Chestnut.
Yes, and that was Dr. Van Hooser's question.
I'm aware of that. Further questions? We do have a motion.
Yes. So basically, we're just voting on this evening, just to think of.
Correct, sir.
But we're going to be able to come. They're going to come back with this some way of having.
Absolutely. We're going to be reengineering this very soon.
Well, I was going to pull my motion if we weren't. I thought we were going to have the water also.
That to me is a very important area to the city of Enid. Further discussion, comments? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 1-2-5-1.
Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Item 585. Consider and take possible action to authorize the Direct Municipal Finance Services, Inc. to proceed with the proposed issuance of indebtedness by the Enid Municipal Authority in the amount of $5,020,000 plus estimated applicable issuance costs by the Enid Municipal Authority to finance capital improvements, authorizing the distribution of bid packets to banks, and authorizing any related action.
No, we don't have to stall. David came back. This is the continuation of what we have been going on for several weeks now, almost the minute we finished the budget, trying to get ourselves in a position where unrestricted EMA fund balance would make us an attractive loan candidate. We have now come up with a kind of a budget compromise number after all of us worked on this at one component or another. We took a lot of input and a lot of sweat on it, and Dave and I sat down over lunch and we talked to everybody and we put more time into it downstairs, and we have a budget compromise number that we're going to be coming back at a future meeting to do yet another, hopefully the last big budget amendment of the year. The result being that we will be proposing a debt financing number to allow the unrestricted EMA fund balance to be increased and to do the projects we've selected, as well as keep in mind that we are deferring some for future years. The number that I'm about to make a motion for is made up of several projects and is really adding to one big pot that all these projects pull out of. So I will make a motion that we take action to, I'm trying to make sure I word this right for the sake of Linda, to proceed with a proposed issuance of indebtedness by the Enid Municipal Authority in the amount of $5,520,000.
Second.
Motion by Ben, second by?
I have a comment I would like to make.
David, did you second it?
Yes, sir.
Ed. Tammy.
I have a comment I would like to make. It's been characterized over the last month and a half or so that we have been, arguing or fighting, or that this has been an unfriendly process. And frankly, that isn't the case at all. We have had disagreements. We have seven different people up here with seven different backgrounds and walks of life, and we all have different things we want to do and we want to see. And this is how city government works. And frankly, if we all sat up here and didn't disagree, I think that as a community, you should be more disheartened by that than by people that are passionate about wanting to do what's right for the community. So I would like to say that we are all still friends, and I know not that that matters, but I think that the fact that it's been characterized otherwise is unfair because that's not true. We haven't been fighting. We haven't been screaming at each other. This is an incredibly stressful thing to work out, and we're trying to do what's best with your money. And I think that the fact that we could all sit down and cut things that we didn't want to cut and put things in we didn't want to put in, I think it speaks volumes for everybody for their effort and the time they put in it, and I commend everybody for the hard work they did on the budget. Thank you.
I agree with you, Tammy. Well said.
Not pat ourselves on the back too much until we get six votes for something, but...
I'm planning on voting for this proposal, but I want to make it clear, too, that the fact that we approve this proposal doesn't mean that we're obviously going to vote to approve all of the items that are listed on this compromise.
That's true.
That's correct.
We're going to have to approve each and every one of those projects as they come up, and I think there's going to be some disagreement on those. I think I can almost...
it's a given.
No!
You think that's a given?
I think so.
Further discussion. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. David Van Hooser, you bent the most. Thank you for what you and Ben did. Item 9.
Mr. Gilbert, if I may.
Whoops, I'm sorry.
We need to pull item 915.
Yes.
We are not ready to execute that.
915, Chris?
Yes, sir.
9.15 is one that Dr. V wanted to pull.
9.2.
9.2, yes, please.
V wants to pull 9.2.
I'll move we approve everything except 9.2 and 9.15.
Second.
Motion by Ben, second by Tammy. Further discussion? Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Let's take item 9.2 first. 9.2. reads, award a contract to Lane Christensen Company, Guthrie, Oklahoma, for the 2015 Wellfield Improvements Project number W-1512A, in the amount of $1,012,856, and authorize the mayor to execute all contract documents after review by the city attorney.
I want to make a motion that we not approve this item.
We need a motion to not approve, or do we just need a vote no on a motion to approve? Which one is cleaner?
You can do it either way. But
okay, we can do it either way.
But his motion is cool. To not approve, so he needs a second.
I have one.
Or it can die for a lack of a second.
Just a minute. We have a motion. Not hearing a second.
I'll make a motion that we approve item 9.2.
Second.
Motion by Ron, second by Ben. Further discussion?
Can we hear his presentation?
Yes, sir.
There is an option like...
Speak into the mic so we can hear you.
There is an option in the contract to award only four wells for $812,000 rather than five wells. So...
Four at a total of what?
$812,000. $139.
That is an option. I think that was.
It's a base bid, yeah.
So the alternate was apparently one more.
One more well, yes.
Brings it to the $1,012,000.
Yeah.
It'd be nice to have all five. Yes. 4 would be good to ensure right. that we don't run into problems. I think that we do. We did show with some math down there that our capacity would probably be okay, but I'm concerned about every day there's wells that Bruce has to adjust and shut down. It takes 4 to 6 months to bring these online. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So anyway, I think it would be good to approve some of them anyway.
Well, I think we right. are, when we are doing these well field improvements, this is an investment that's going to pay dividends for a long time. Even when we have a pipeline to CAW, this is a resource that the city of Enid can use if need be. This is a resource that will add flexibility to our pipeline to CAW Lake. It's also a resource that we can theoretically consider leasing to another community, leasing to somebody else at some point in the future as a revenue stream after we have a pipeline up and running, assuming it is doing everything we want it to do. We're going to be happy in 10 years that we have done this gradual investment in our well field infrastructure. I mean, I understand the concern that that would be nice to have that number bumped up in our unrestricted fund, but I think we're going to find ourselves regretting that we don't do it if we choose not to today. But it is just kind of a guess, isn't it?
Where would this money come from?
This year's budget. It's budgeted in 14-15.
It come from the water capital, which ultimately comes from EMA. It'd be a transfer from EMA.
To me, it's what we have now.
No, and I completely agree. The water is absolutely the number one priority. It's the top thing we need to do. And I'm not against ever drilling these 5 wells. It's just like any of the other things that we've been talking about for the last month. There are priorities in terms of what needs to be done, what needs to be done later. I'm pretty confident based on the math that unless we lose a whole lot of water wells all at once, that we're going to be fine for another couple of years. We've already established that even these 5 wells will only add at best, we don't even know how much they're going to produce, but at best, 1 million gallons a day, and they won't come online until after we've already been through this summer's crisis. So that doesn't benefit us at all. So we also just now agreed to spend $750,000 in the 15-16 budget on well field improvements and redoing. So, you know, we need to do them, and I completely agree. I just don't see the need today. I think it's another opportunity, like so many compromises that we've already made, to add another $1 million to our reserve fund at the end of this budget. When the audit is done, there'll be another $1 million there. If next year 2 or 3 wells crash all at once and we absolutely have to do something, we'll be playing catch-up, arguably, because it takes 6 months. But we have many times approved emergency awards, emergency contracts. We've modified the budget throughout the year, which we will no doubt do next year. We find ourselves at the end of this summer in a crisis, then we'll drill the wells this fall and this winter, and we'll have them by next spring if that happens. But based on the math and the fact that Coke is going to drop off a couple of million gallons a day, and we're not going to get the canola plant in the immediate plans, which is part of what the Guernsey, the reason they recommended 5 new wells a year, had all those assumptions built in, which are not true now. So I just think it's something we can defer. I completely agree. Water's top priority, but this is $1 million that we could easily set on for 8 to 10 months, and it won't make any difference to the citizens of this community, but it would add money to our budget. So that's why I want to vote no, not never, but not no for now.
And it doesn't get it into our system. Right, it just drills the wells. So then we would have additional expense to get it into our pipeline.
Well, it gets us part of the way to our system.
2 miles.
2 miles of pipe, and it'll take a little. How much more will it take to get it to our system?
About another 4 more miles.
Okay.
How expensive will that be? Do you have a guess?
We are looking at about $500 to $700,000.
See, I mean, this is a $2 million thing we're voting on. It's worthless if we can't get the line to the system.
Now, it doesn't help us this summer, but it would help us for summer of 2016, probably. Well,
let's spend the money in 2016.
If we spend it in 2016, it won't help us till 2017. Yeah.
Ron.
In the last 10 years, we've spent millions of dollars studying our water situation, trying to improve our water situation. We got an opportunity here to pick up some water, and I think we're idiots if we don't take it. I mean, this is just something we need to do. The well fields aren't going to go away. I think we'll be using these well fields 50 years from now. Don't make any promises.
I'm not based on me. That's what Guernsey says. Nothing lasts 50 years. Yeah. That's why we're.
That's why you have to keep buying new ones.
Well, they probably thought that 50 years ago too. Anyway, Got a motion to second, Mayor.
Motion on item 9.2.
Is it for the full amount or for the
That's my next question. Good point.
It's the amount that's on the agenda.
So that gives us 2 miles of pipeline. We still have to pay for 4 more miles.
We do have $750,000 in next year's budget, as was pointed out. I'm assuming part of that's going to be spent to get this water to where it can be used.
I wish we could just compromise and just drill a couple, 3 wells by recognition.
I too think we're better off to do it, and we'll be happy we did 10 years from now.
If this motion fails, could someone make a motion to do 3 wells and come back and vote on that?
Well, 4 would
be
the base.
Well, you can't do
it.
Yeah.
That wasn't the bid.
Wait a minute.
Right.
Wait a minute.
Four, yeah, you're right, the base bid amount, you're right.
What is your answer, Andrea?
Yeah, you could come back in with a motion to do 4, because that's the base bid. But you couldn't come back with 3 because 3 weren't bid. Mm-hmm.
We're going to vote on the $1,012,856. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 4-3. Item, 9.15?
No, we're just pulling that one.
That one's pulled.
I'm sorry, I just pulled it. Go to item 10. Wait a minute. Yes. Item 10. We'll now recess to convene as the Enid Municipal Authority. Item 11, all of the trustees of the Enid Municipal Authority are in attendance. Item 12, the Enid Municipal Authority regular meeting is now in session. Item 12.1, consider and take possible action to direct Municipal Finance Service, Inc. to proceed with the proposed issuance of indebtedness in the amount of $5,020,000 plus estimated applicable insurance costs by the Enid Municipal Authority to finance capital improvements, authorizing the distribution of bid packets to banks, and authorizing any related action.
I move we proceed with the proposed issuance of indebtedness in the amount of $5,520,000 plus the rest.
Second.
Motion and a second. Further discussion. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Item 12.2, approval of claims in the amount of $81,471.33.
Move to approve.
Motion by Ben.
Second.
Second by Aaron. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Item 13, we'll now adjourn to convene as the Enid Economic Development Authority. Item 14, all of the trustees of the Enid Economic Development Authority are in attendance at the regular meeting. Item 15, the Enid Economic Development Authority regular meeting is now in session. Item 15.1, approval of claims in the amount of $10,414.70. Rodney.
I'll make a motion.
I have a motion.
Second.
Second by Ron. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0. Way to go, Rodney. We'll now adjourn to reconvene as the Enid City Commission. Under item 17, under public discussion, we have one person signed up. Jimmy Harsel, if you will approach the mic and say your name and your address.
Jimmy Dean Hartzell, 2501 West Cherokee.
Jimmy, what's the rest of that? Isn't it something,
who's your buddy? Yeah. You know, this is the first time, Mayor and City Council, that I've addressed this room as a civilian. For 25 years, I was the electrical contractor for the City of Enid, dealt with everything from ice storms to presidential visits as far as disasters, have saved several of the special community things that we've seen, and I would just ask that each one of you councilmen take a little time and go by and visit with Bruce Boyd and see where we are with this water situation. When I started 25 years ago, wells that pumped 160 gallons a minute are now pumping 20. And so that number of wells that we've got has constricted to such a small amount, and with all of the water the irrigation systems, they're driving those nitrates down into our water supply faster. These new wells are going deeper, getting below the existing aquifers to get to new water that hasn't been tapped before. So it's going to be clean. It's going to be good water. Thank you for all for passing that. But like I said, I want to thank everyone because the trails and everything that we're doing in Enid is fantastic. I mean, when you drive into Enid and you see these nice, clean walkways going around, it is incredible. My only concern is while we're doing all this stuff for the aesthetics, let's not forget when we bring all these people in, if we don't have water for them, or when it comes time for that water to go on down the line to the potty palace, that we've got the lines to get it there too, because our infrastructure is hurting terribly. And I can tell you that because I've seen what we've had to do to move water around. Your lake, all you gotta do is just put a pump down there, pump it wherever you want it. We've done that before. We're amazing. And the engineering folks that we've had, this is the first time that I've really seen engineering, technical services, and all the different departments start to work together. And I'm sad that I'm on the other side of it now as a civilian, but I am sure that I'm going to stay in Enid so I can enjoy it. And God bless you all, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Under item 18, consider convening into executive session pursuant to 25 Oklahoma Statute 307C10 to discuss matters pertaining to economic development, because an executive session is necessary to protect the confidentiality of the business and to reconvene into regular session to take any necessary action.
So moved.
A motion by Rodney.
Second.
Second by Ben. Please cast your vote. Motion carries 7-0.